So I am now going to kind of step away from the methods almost completely. So I am going to talk about how oscillations have revealed new aspects of brain function, and not really worry how these results have been obtained. And I will start with the paper from 1944. This is a paper by E.D. Adrian, who obtained a Nobel Prize for his work in electrophysiology in 1932. And this work is now EEG, surface EEG. And it's remarkable that I can include all the figures of this paper in a single slide. There are all figures from the paper. And this makes one think that we should think more and maybe focus less on fancy illustrations. And in fact, in this paper, almost all of the aspects of the experiments that I am going to describe are present. The first figure, figure one here, is normal alpha rhythm recorded from the occipital areas. And you see there that the alpha rhythm comes and goes. It has these spindles in a few second time scale. But this is not all what was in the paper. In the next figure here, you see that there's this alpha rhythm spindle occurring here in the middle. And what happened in this experiment was that the subject attended either to vision or to sounds that he heard. And when he attended to the sounds, there was a modulation of the alpha. The alpha in the occipital areas appeared during this attention to the sounds. This is something I would say very modern, considering that this was published in 1944. And finally, the third figure shows that if you present periodic stimuli, a flickering light, you observe, instead of the alpha rhythm, an oscillation which has the frequency of the flicker. So this is a steady state response in the visual cortex. And he goes further even in the text. He describes how the flickering frequency may interact with the alpha oscillations in the visual cortex. And I will talk about these types of frequency interactions also later in my talk. Those of you who were in the inauguration of this center saw already this remarkable quotation from the paper, which says that that's a very long way, that's the data he presented, from saying that the EEG can tell us how the subject will think and act. In fact, the information which it gives relates to a very limited field. But the limitation arises mainly from the fact that we can only record the cross effects and not the detailed patterns in the brain. That is, we are not close enough to the brain. With present methods, which means the surface EEG, the skull and the scalp are too much in the way, and we need some new physical method to read through them. And somehow MEG is the physical method that directly reads through the skull and doesn't get affected by the skull much. And finally, he says that in these days we may look with some confidence to the physicists to produce such an instrument, for it's just the sort of thing they can do. And indeed this happened in some 25 years later. Quite the paper. So here's a more modern version from the 90s with the 122 whole head MEG instrument of the recording of not only the visual alpha rhythm, which occurs here in the occipital parts of the brain, but also simultaneously the mu rhythm, which is the oscillations in the motor and somatosensory cortices. And here we have now four different traces for this alpha rhythm location in the back and the mu rhythm location here. And the first trace up here is eyes closed and hands in rest. So you see a huge peak in the alpha rhythm, and you see another peak in the so-called beta range in 20 hertz, around 20 hertz, in the in the occipital areas. And this is greatly dampened when you open the eyes. And in the visual areas, it stays the same irrespective of the other two conditions when you move the left or the right hands, in which case the rhythms in the somatomotor areas are dampened. They are not dampened by opening the eyes, as long as the hands are in rest. Now let's let's move kind of to the next figure of Adrian's paper and talk about the modulation of these rhythms. So in this experiment, the subject performed a brief finger movement here, shown by this bar. And before the movement, there was a certain level of 10 hertz activity and 20 hertz activity. So this is now not the time course of the signal itself, but the time course of the rhythmic activity. If you like, it's one line of the time frequency representation. And you see that there's, especially in the alpha range, there's a dampening of the rhythmic activity and then a rebound. And these rebounds in 20 hertz and in 10 hertz are occurring at different rates. So clearly these two oscillatory activities are dissociated from each other. They are not some kind of harmonic components of each other, because they behave differently in time after this task. They are separated by this different rebound. So this is not the harmonic distortion of the 10 hertz, in other words. And furthermore, if you look at the source locations, that is when you fit current dipoles to the data, which we will talk about tomorrow, you will see that if this is the Landig fissure here, the 10 hertz activity tends to be more on the somatosensory side, and the 20 hertz activity tends to be more on the motor side. So they are also dissociated by spatial location. Yuri is squinting his eyes.
I'm trying to see a difference in this location.
So this is the location of the hand somatosensory area as determined by median nerve somatosensory response. And what is kind of interesting is that these rhythms are dissociated in a third way. And this is that if you perform movements with different parts of the body, the 20 hertz temporal change of the rhythmic activity moves with the body parts. So these dots are the locations of a nerve, of the somatosensory response to a nerve stimulation in the foot, in the hand, and in the lip. These are for the right side, and these are for the left side. So these mark the corresponding locations in the somatosensory homunculus. And now you see clearly that, hopefully more clearly, that all these blobs here are in front, more in front of the somatosensory activity. And this type of change in the 20 hertz activity is occurring in an area which corresponds to the somatosensory locations according to the movement. So if you move your toes, then the change in the rhythmic activity is more in the midline, and then moves to the side when you go to the hands and finally to the mouth. Now, what was also remarkable in this experiment was that the 10 hertz change didn't move. It was always in the hand area. So somehow this also indicates that the 10 hertz is different from the 20 hertz, in the sense that it's located differently and modulated differently depending on the on the location or body part that was moving. Now another thing about the rhythmic activity is that you can start to give explanations in terms of what mechanistic explanations in terms of what is probably happening in the brain causing this rhythmic activity. And this is what we have done with Chris Moore and Stephanie Jones. So the idea is that we perform MEG measurements. They might be evoked response studies like these or ongoing activity, rhythmic activity studies. So, yes?
Can you just point at that because
I really
see the figures.
So, if it appears. I will use that.
Thank you.
So let me go back. So we perform MEC experiments, either evoked response studies here, or then look at the rhythmic activity as indicated by these time frequency representations. And then we have a biophysical model which can predict actually the macroscopic net current is time behavior in the cortex, so that we have an assembly of neurons in the model, and then we make certain assumptions about the connections and see how we can predict changes in evoked responses and oscillatory activity according to the conditions. In evoked responses we looked at stimuli which were just at the level of detection, so that if the same stimulus was detected versus not detected, the evoked response was different, and we looked at what might predict this. And then for the rhythmic activity we looked at, for example, the statistics of the rhythmic activity preceding the stimulus depending on the condition, and this was quite successful. Now, you don't quite yet believe that this model is correct on the basis of this human data. It could be kind of accidental that the model predicts the human data. But fortunately, rats are not so different from humans as far as somatosensory cortex is concerned. And therefore, Stephanie and Chris Moore went on to conduct experiments in rats which were somehow similar to the human experiments to get an idea whether this explanation was correct or not. So in this way this biophysical model can connect the oscillations in the humans to oscillations in animal models, and we can get more information of what actually happens in the brain. What does the brain do to produce these oscillations? And as an example of this, I will show a kind of an accidental finding. We found that the age range in our experiments was large enough to show age-related differences in the mean power of beta band 20 Hz oscillations, so that the power was on the average smaller in younger adults than in middle-aged adults. And as shown here, we were able to associate this with certain changes in the model, namely that there were if we increase the drive extraneous drive from the thalamus and also the feedback inputs between the cortex, be able to increase the pre-stimulus beta as we found in the middle-aged adults. So this is kind of interesting that we can also manipulate the model to reflect on changes with age on both oscillations and also in this case with the somatosensory evoked fields. Now, we have mainly talked about the analysis of oscillations in the sensor space, in the MEG sensors or EEG electrodes so far. But really, it's beneficial, as already hinted by these previous slides to look at the data in the brain in by using source modeling, which we will talk about tomorrow. So that what we hope to achieve with source modeling is that there will be less spread in the signals, so that we can better dissociate signals coming from different regions, and also dissociate false correlations, which we will talk about later this week. And in particular, if the source estimation method is a linear mapping from the sensors to the sources, then we can conduct many signal processing operations either in the sensor or the source space, and make this choice according to computational efficiency. But still we need to take into account that the source estimation doesn't resolve this spatial resolution problem completely, and there is still a crosstalk between regions which we need to attend to. But anyhow, early on in the history of the MNE software, we started using methods which take the sensor space data, which is shown here. So there's one trial with different sensors here, and perform the wavelet transform, and then invert the data to the source space. And in this case, we did what we didn't really talk about theoretically yet, namely to determine the relative phase of the stimulus and the signals that we get from the wavelet transform. And then we asked, where does this phase locking occur? But first, let's look at just in a sensor space at response that we got in this auditory paradigm, so in which we had an ongoing 40 hertz tone and the oscillating tone, and then in the beginning of this long tone we have this onset response and then a DC kind of sustained field, and on top of this sustained field we see this oscillation, which turns out to be oscillation at the stimulus frequency, but it doesn't really start immediately when the stimulus starts, but takes a little bit of time to develop. And in addition, to improve the spatial resolution, we also correlated, or actually constrained the data with the fMRI, which was collected in the same paradigm. And in the following, I will show a movie not of this time frequency analysis, but actually of the phase locking between the stimulus and time frequency data as a function of time, without using the fMRI as a constraint and with using fMRI as a constraint. So this is in the following movie. So you will notice that the phase locking develops later in the time. Now we go back to the beginning soon now. And here the phase locking starts to develop, but without the fMRI constraint it's rather widespread, but the fMRI in this auditory case very reasonably constrains the signals to the auditory cortex.
Was this from published papers?
Yes.
Which one?
This is from the paper on the first slide.
They don't show on these printouts any.
Yeah, we can't read.
You can't read any text on the slides.
Will they get the PDF later?
We'll get the PDF later. Right.
In this case, what would you have attributed those false positives to?
So in this case, they are basically due to the fact that the source estimate is spread still in space. Mm-hmm. And the phase locking value is an amplitude independent measure, so that you easily get false positives because you are basically doing a correlation, and that's not depending on the amplitude. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
They use the fMRI just a mask?
It's not just a mask really, it's there's a more chance for the activity to be where the ephemera is, but there's still the activity is still allowed to be elsewhere also. So that it doesn't completely restrict it to ephemera. Then about steady state responses locked to the stimulation frequencies. Now this experiment is quite curious. So this is actually an example of what we call frequency tacking. And as many of you know, the auditory system is not completely wired so that only the contralateral auditory area would be activated, but both auditory areas are activated even if the stimulus is only to one ear. And that's indicated here by this thick line going from the right ear to the left auditory cortex and a thinner line going to the right auditory cortex, which is ipsilateral to the stimulus, and similarly to the left ear stimuli shown with the red lines. And now, what we did in this experiment was to present sounds which were amplitude modulated at two different frequencies, 20 Hz and 26 Hz. So that this amplitude modulation could be used kind of as a tracer of where the signals go, because the sounds were labeled with this frequency. And what is shown here are spectra for three different conditions. Either that the sound was presented to the contralateral ear, to the ipsilateral ear, or both ears. So, for example, the blue line indicates that only the blue stimulus was presented, so that left hemisphere received. For left hemisphere it was a contralateral stimulus, and for the right hemisphere it was an ipsilateral stimulus. And now if you, and the same holds true for the red, for the left hemisphere auditory cortex, the red stimulus was an ipsilateral stimulus, and for the right hemisphere the red stimulus was a contralateral stimulus. And now, if you, for example, look at the right hemisphere, it's clear that the contralateral stimulus produces a larger response than the ipsilateral stimulus, and vice versa for the left hemisphere. Now, something interesting happens in the case where both stimuli were presented simultaneously. So the right hemisphere. So first of all, in the right hemisphere, you see that both this signal and this signal were attenuated contralateral, not as much as the ipsilateral signal were attenuated. Whereas in the left hemisphere, the contralateral stimulus response was about the same. So that it turns out that for right-handed people there's some kind of preference to using the right ear. Maybe we even tilt our head kind of in the direction. But this tracing method was actually recently used in a rather interesting way to look at what kind of effect but some gene expression might have.
Quick question about this 94. So then why it's just for to show the to illustrate the differences. It's not really like there's a baseline shift between them, right? It's like
no.
You have to look at the green one and then relative, like within the green one.
Yes.
Relative.
Yes.
Not that there's an absolute.
Right.
Okay.
Now, it turns out that there's a gene which is associated with dyslexia in a dominant manner. So this gene is called RoBo1, and then in Helsinki they happened to find a family in which there were many dyslexic persons with this gene expressed. And now they wanted to know whether there's something related to the auditory system wrong with the genes, because it had been gene with, because it was speculated before that there might be something wrong in the crossing of the auditory pathways here, which might affect these types of oscillatory responses. And indeed, that turned out to be the case. So now we need to be careful. So these are the responses to ipsilateral sounds, and these are the responses to the contralateral sounds in the left hemisphere and in the right hemisphere for consoles and these dyslexic individuals. And then they compared these responses to the binaural responses. And you can see very clearly that in the consoles, the binaural responses were smaller for the ipsilateral sounds in both hemispheres. But for these individuals with this gene and dyslexia, there was clearly no dampening in the responses. So there's something measurably wrong in the crossing of the auditory pathways here in the middle, which is difficult actually to see, maybe even impossible to see even with finest DTI, because these differences are in a very confined area in the brainstem, so that it's just a few millimeters by few millimeters area where this crossing happens. And these bars show the relative dampening of these responses between the monaural and binaural conditions, and indeed in normals there was a big dampening, and in the dyslexic individuals there was a smaller dampening, so that it may be that there are also effects which relate to very basic auditory properties of the brain to which are associated with dyslexia.
Matti?
Yes.
Have similar studies been done on visual, the crossings in the visual pathways?
I don't know whether there are frequency tracking experiments like that, but I have shown actually another visual frequency tracking experiment in a moment.
They have done it with like going towards alpha or gamma and seeing how attention is sort of lateralized and sort of improved if it's in like 40 hertz.
But not for the slices.
But not for it, no. And not for the crossing at zero.
Then Stephen gave this excellent idea to also mention that there are experiments in which instead of these artificial tones, people have used natural periodic stimuli to evoke steady state responses, that is speech. And there are means to retain the time frequency content of the speech, basically, but make it ununderstandable. And in this experiment, they varied this mixing of the speech so that this one channel, as they call it, means that the speech was unintelligible, and in 16 channels it was normal speech. And then when looking at the sentences that were presented, they contained envelopes between 4 and 7 hertz. And what they actually observed was that the phase locking between neural activity, that is MEG signals in the auditory cortices, was strongest in this very frequency band. And then this is the result with the speech, which has been kind of completely scrambled, and you still see the phase locking, but it's important that if you go from this speech which has been scrambled to normal speech, then the phase locking increases in the left auditory cortex, and these other open bars are just phase lockings between random speech sequences and random signals from the auditory cortices, showing that there is much less phase locking, so that this is a true effect and not the random effect, basically. So this does indicate the significance. So really in the left hemisphere there was specifically significant difference in the phase locking between speech and something which was just speech-like but was not speech. So you can also, using these methods, look at something which is very, very unique to humans in terms of relationship of brain activity and the sounds. Then a visual experiment which uses this type of frequency tracking. So this is the stimulus. You certainly know this illusion and see, after staring at it here in the middle for a while, that the vase and vase percepts alternate. It's well known that this alternation of these two percepts follows a gamma probability distribution, and indeed this was also observed in this experiment. But I bet you don't really see in this noisy figure is that these noises are flickering at different frequencies, 12 and 15 hertz. So we smuggled a tracer here, kind of, but you don't perceive it. You cannot tell that there's a difference. And then if we look at the spectrum of the MEG in the visual areas in the back of the head, just from an occipital sensor, we see peaks at 12 hertz and 15 hertz, corresponding to these flickering frequencies. And now things become interesting when you relate to a time frequency analysis. So this is time and this is frequency, and asked when the subject sees the change. And you can see that when he sees the vase, more 12 hertz, and then the faces, there's more 15 hertz. And we tried hard to prove this false, for example, assuming that there was a difference in the gaze which would cause this, but no. So we are kind of, with help of this frequency tracking, eavesdropping the brain. So the next question is, where does this exactly come from in the brain? And for that purpose, we performed a more detailed analysis, that is, we did linear regression of the data segments following the percept change shown here to the two DAC frequencies, then background activity frequencies, line frequency disturbance, and finally linear trend. And then we basically obtain the regression coefficients of these different frequencies, not in the sensors, but in the brain space, so that we have used the source model to map the data to the brain. And then we asked, where do we first of all have significant activity in these frequencies? And the answer is that it's mostly in the visual cortices here. So this is an inflated view of the brain, so that this is the calcarine sulcus in the back of the head. And if we take an ROI from here, where the there's a relationship between the stimulus and the activity. According to the regression, we see that there is a systematic change between the ratio of these two frequencies, so that there's more of the vase frequency when the vases are perceived. Of course, this change in the visual cortices is not happening only there, but it's caused by something which is coming downstream from higher areas, but these higher areas cannot follow this high stimulation frequency so well. But anyhow we can see changes in the brain at these two frequencies, and this might give you some ideas of experiments where you can smuggle in your stimuli some tracers which tell you where the signals are going. And you notice that I changed the order of these experiments a little bit, so that I will present last maybe the most complicated experiment, in which we studied how oscillations are different, and especially their connectivity is different between normals and typically developing subjects and autistic individuals. And in this experiment we used an event-related paradigm, in which we presented either faces or houses, because autistic individuals have a difficulty in relating to their environment or human aspects of it, and therefore we expect changes in this particular paradigm. And we looked at many things. We looked at first long-range connectivity, that is coherence between signals in the brain at specific frequencies, which we will talk more about in the following days. And in addition, we looked at local connectivity. We looked at phase-amplitude coupling, which means that we asked whether the amplitude of oscillations in a higher frequency are correlated with the changes of the phase or amplitude of lower frequency oscillations. If let's say 5 Hz activity goes up, is 50 Hz activity going up also as the in concert overall? And finally we looked at whether these changes are correlated with the clinical scoring of these subjects. And there were several steps in this analysis. First, about the evoked responses to the houses and faces. So faces are always blue and houses are red. And autism spectrum disorder subjects are shown in dashed lines, and typically developing subjects are shown in solid lines. And you see very remarkably that the evoked responses are almost the same for the two subject groups in the fusiform face area, which was delineated with help of these evoked responses for further analysis. And there was no difference between fearful or angry faces in either of these subject groups. So on the basis of an evoked response study, you couldn't say anything much about these people. Let's go further. So here is the fusiform face area again. And then we looked at coherence at different frequencies from this seed area to different parts of the cortex. And then we looked at areas where there is a difference between the faces and houses conditions. And then finally we looked at where there's a difference of these differences. So whether these groups are different in showing these differences. And the typically developing subjects shown in the upper row show differences in between these conditions in the connectivity from the fusiform face area specifically in three different areas, the precuneus, anterior cingulate cortex, and inferior frontal gyrus. And interestingly, these differences peaked at different latencies, which anecdotally seems to be longer as you go away from this fusiform phase area. If it's here, so this is the shortest distance, then this is probably the next longest distance, and hard to say, but then anterior cingulate may be the longest. And certainly the autistic individuals didn't show a contrast in the same way, so that there would be a higher coherence for the faces than houses. They, if anything, showed lower coherence for the faces than houses. So these two groups differentiated clearly in this respect of the data, not in the evoked responses, but in frequency-specific coherence in the alpha band. Now, this is long-range connectivity. There has been discussion whether short-range connectivity within the area is also impaired in autism, and for this we cannot use these coherence measures because we cannot really differentiate between locations with such a small area as the fusiform phase area. But what we can do is to attribute this local connectivity change to impaired relationship between oscillations within the area at different frequencies. And this is done here. So this is phase amplitude coupling. We ask whether the abundance of higher frequency oscillation goes up when the lower frequency oscillation goes up and then goes down when lower frequency oscillation goes down. And the answer is yes. So that we see coupling of the phase of lower frequency oscillations here to higher frequency oscillation amplitudes at specific frequencies in both axes. So that in the houses condition, there's little coupling in neutral phases more, and in emotional phases even more, which is totally different in the ASD. And in particular, if you compare the houses and emotional phases condition, for example, the ASD subjects didn't show nothing much significant, whereas the normal subjects showed clearly this contrast. And finally, this contrast was only present in the fusiform phase area. We scanned the whole brain and we couldn't find the contrast in elsewhere. So now we have three long-range connectivities and this local connectivity change. And next question is to ask whether these changes are related to the clinical scoring of the subject. And the answer is yes. So this is a five-dimensional plot, so it's a little bit difficult to understand. Mm-hmm. But this shows that you can make a five-dimensional plot. So these three axes here are the long-range coherences from the fusiform phase area to the inferior frontal gyrus, to precuneus and anterior cingulate cortex, so that these constitute dots in the three-dimensional space. Then the size of the circle is the local phase to amplitude coupling between low and high frequencies. And finally, the color is kind of the clinical scoring probability of autistic versus not. So red is autistic and zero is not. And now if you look at this, it's very clear that there's a separation here. All the autistic subjects are closer to the origin and have smaller circles, so that they have smaller local coupling. So that this is, I think, very important to realize that this is not a group data. each of these subjects can be analyzed separately and produce this result, and it's very clear separation between the two conditions. So maybe in this way, performing this rather simple experiment but rather complicated analysis, you could actually make an objective measure which could quickly even see whether some potential treatment would be helpful. So remember that the experiment was rather easy to do, but the analysis was complicated. But once you know what to do, then you can streamline the steps. And that's what they have actually done, because they had many subjects, so that they couldn't do this without streamlining the steps. And this also emphasizes the importance of having analysis tools which can be adjusted to a certain task and then can be used to process a lot of subjects in batch. So that was my last example, and then we will continue forward to the